There's a good chance that if you have seen veganism in the news, it came with a headline along the lines of "Militant veganism is out of control," or "Farmers sent death threats by vegans."
What I have a real problem with is radical vegans storming into supermarkets.
Militant vegans who will take it to the extreme, who will be violent, who will be offensive, who will be frankly quite frightening.
In fact, back in early 2018, the BBC ran a piece about a farmer called Allison who said that vegans were sending farmers death threats, with the BBC reporting that she had been receiving death threats herself.
You do get death threats, which is quite ironic coming from people that want peace for animals and everything, but then they tell you that, you know, "Oh, I hope you and your family go and die in a hole for what you do."
This caused a huge outcry, with national press coverage declaring how farmers were living in fear. However, Allison later stated that she had not had people making specific death threats towards her, which, although entirely contradicting the statement made by the BBC, had no effect on diminishing the narrative of frightened farmers living in fear of militant vegans. Nor did the BBC amend or change their original piece. If we consider that vegans are also sent death threats by farmers and meat eaters, and that Jude Capper, the founder of the pro-dairy campaign FebruDairy, and who was also actively involved in perpetuating this story, liked a tweet talking about shooting vegans during this media frenzy, it becomes clear that the media are using this narrative, not because they are outraged about threats, as unfortunately most outspoken people on social media have received threats in one form or another, but because it plays into a deeper narrative, which is the portrayal of veganism and animal rights as being militant, problematic, and dangerous. Something that exists outside of normalized society and poses a direct threat to normalized society's citizens and traditions.
But I think the point is, how far are you prepared to go?
It's one of the oldest tricks in the book, the ad hominem attack of those who want to disrupt the status quo. Ad hominem attacks are an effective way of avoiding debating the actual issues the group you are attacking are raising for discourse. If you can't argue against the message, you attack the messenger to try and muddy their public image. This is the reason why we live in a paradoxical society that says that those who kill dogs are psychopaths, those who kill pigs are normal, and those who kill neither are extremists. Nobody watches footage of pigs screaming in gas chambers and then believes it to be extreme to abstain from causing this violence. We have instead been told to view the people who abstain as being extreme, hugely due to the narrative the media portrays of vegans. For example, when activists in the UK occupied a pig farm in 2019, the media accused these vegans of killing piglets in an attempt to discredit them and perpetuate the narrative of frightened farmers being terrorised. However, live streams from the activists inside showed the piglets were already dead when the activists entered the farm. And on top of that, dead piglets were found lying around the farm. This was completely ignored, as it didn't suit the narrative the media wanted to push. On top of that, a story about a vegan climber dying on Mount Everest back in 2016 became a global news story. Even though around 300 people have died climbing Everest, not to mention that vegans have also climbed Everest and survived. And perhaps even more insidiously, back in 2019, a report came out attempting to discredit the WHO's analysis of more than 800 studies that found that processed meat and red meat are class 1 and class 2 carcinogens. The report was heavily criticized by public health researchers, including the American Heart Association, the American Cancer Society, and the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health, and was conducted by a research group that receives funding from AgriLife, a program that works with the Texas Beef Checkoff, and includes a beef cattle teaching program, educational workshops for cattle ranchers, and promotion of Texas beef to consumers. However, all of this wasn't enough to stop Philip Schofield, one of the most popular presenters on British television, defiantly declaring on live television to millions of people,
"Bacon is back on the menu."
All whilst heart disease continues to be the number one killer of people in the UK, and colon cancer continues to be the second most deadly cancer. It's important to recognise that it was only around 80 years ago that there were adverts promoting the idea that doctors recommended smoking cigarettes, and even that pregnant women should smoke as well.
"What cigarette do you smoke, doctor?"
These were mainstream ideas perpetuated by the media at that time. even though there was significant, credible evidence to the contrary. Furthermore, many of the norms that our society heralds as sources of great pride now were once seen as extreme beliefs held by militant people who existed on the fringes of society and who wanted to cause disruption and harm. So perhaps we should look to our past to recognize the reality of our present. That often how we feel about something is not actually how we feel, but instead a product of how we've been told to feel. It makes sense that we want to be told good things about the way that we live, and bad things about those who are showing us the reasons to change. And whether we like it or not, portraying vegans as extremists generates clicks and revenue for these media companies. But in the words of the comedian David Mitchell, the thing that's annoying about there suddenly being a lot of them, vegans, is the nagging suspicion that they might be right, when there were hardly any vegans. I hardly ever had to think about that.